May I request Dr. T.C.A. Raghavan, Director General, Indian Council of World Affairs, to welcome our distinguished guest with a bouquet of flowers. Thank you, sir. Allow me to brief you about the program. We'll start with the welcome remarks by Dr. T.C.A. Raghavan, DG ICWA. Thereafter, His Excellency Mr. Pushpa Kamal Dahal, Prachanda, will deliver the 31st Sapru House lecture. This lecture will be followed by a 15-minute Q&A session. We hope to conclude by 16 hours. Before we begin, may I request all of you to kindly switch off your mobiles or set it on silent mode. I would now like to invite DG ICWA to give his welcome remarks and conduct the proceedings.
Shri M.G. Akbar, Minister of State, Ministry of External Affairs, His Excellency Bharat Regmi, Chargé of the Nepalese Embassy in Delhi, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. It is a very great honor for me to welcome His Excellency Pushpa Kumar Dahal Prachanda to deliver the 31st Sapru House Lecture. The Indian Council for World Affairs, as it is constituted today, unites two different streams of endeavor, one of the past and the other more contemporary. In 1943, a group of eminent public figures under Tej Bahadur Sapru joined together to think about India and the world in a systemic and institutionalized manner. They formed this council, and it represents one of our very early efforts to widen the foreign policy and strategic community and fraternity of the country beyond the realms of government. The second stream was a parliamentary intervention and enactment in 2001, declaring the ICWA as an institution of national importance and the Vice President of India as the President of the Council. Our endeavor is to remain faithful to both these currents as we discuss, debate, and deliberate on the issues of our time in a non-partisan and open manner. One of these issues certainly is of India's role in South Asia. And in that context, His Excellency Mr. Prachanda's remarks on Indo-Nepal relations have for us both relevance and great significance. The Sapru House Lecture Series is part of the tradition of widening the discussion on foreign policy and related issues. And those who have spoken from this platform include His Excellency Mr. Mohammad Ashraf Ghani, President of the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan, Mr. James Alex Mitchell, President of the Republic of Seychelles, His Excellency Mr. Ban Ki-moon, United Nations Secretary General, His Excellency Dr. Viktor Orbán, Prime Minister of Hungary, and many others. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, His Excellency Mr. Prachanda needs no introduction to any audience in Sapru House. He is a well-known figure in India and a former Prime Minister of Nepal. In Nepal itself, he has been a prominent figure of the country's political and social landscape with his leadership of the Communist Party of Nepal. His career as a political activist, a social revolutionary, and a public intellectual occupies a prominent part of the modern and contemporary history of Nepal. His role in bringing peace and advancing the agenda of social justice and inclusion in Nepal is well known, and in so many ways he is the face of transformation in Nepal as the country has undergone a period of political transformation for establishing a multi-party democracy. Mr. Prachanda has been a strong votary of expanding India-Nepal relations for the benefit of our two peoples and has himself personally contributed immensely to strengthening these relations. Many in the audience would recall that His Excellency Mr. Prachanda had earlier visited Sapru House and had delivered the third Sapru House lecture in 2013. The theme of his remarks today, and I quote, "Recent developments in Nepal and advancing India-Nepal partnership for shared prosperity," will therefore, I am sure, both look back and also look forward. May I invite you now, sir, to deliver your remarks and enlighten us. Thank you very much.
Chairman of the program, Excellency Minister of State, M.J. Akbarji, dignitaries, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. It is indeed a great honor for me to be invited to speak before this distinguished audience at the 31st Sapru House lecture. This is my second time. As chairman has already been mentioned, to be a part of this prestigious lecture series, I sincerely thank the Indian Council of World Affairs for this opportunity and warm reception. Your invitation to speak on a recent development in Nepal and Nepal-India relations testifies in itself the amount of interest you have in Nepal's affair. We take it as your expression of goodwill towards a stable and prosperous Nepal. Distinguished guests, when I entered this dignified chamber 5 years ago for the third Sapru House lecture, it was completely a different context in Nepal. Back then, we were in the peak of a long and painful political transition. We were toward the end of the term, the First Constituent Assembly, which was formed with so much of excitement and expectation to write for the first time in Nepal's history People's Constitution through elected assembly. But the Constituent Assembly was then making the little headway on critical agendas of constitution making. In a diverse society like ours, where political forces carry contesting ideologies, managing transition was not so easy. Neither was it easy to achieve the kind of political transformation we aspired for. At times, it seemed that transition would never end, and people's agendas that we fought so hard for would never be materialized. Nevertheless, as I stand before you today, it is a different mood in Nepal. Back then, sense of uncertainty surrounded us. Today, a sense of robust optimism. Optimism spawned by the accomplishment of a historical political process that was once thought unreachable. Optimism generated by the conviction that fundamental transformation is possible. Optimism driven by the sense of clarity about the destiny and confidence to reach there. Ladies and gentlemen, I carry before you the same optimism that best describes the sentiment of Nepal and Nepali people today. As a leader of decade-long armed struggle and then the peace process, I have seen ups and downs, ebb and flow up for a long journey. The armed rebellion I led was a struggle against backwardness and injustice, against clutches of feudalism in all its form and manifestation, and against the discrimination and despotism. It was a struggle to awaken, enlighten, and empower the people. And the historic peace process, of course, to institutionalize the agendas that people aspired for, process to found the kind of polity that would serve people best, a process to translate people's enlightened idea of desired socio-political arrangement into a set of governing documents. The process was never easy and it took time. Dear friends, what Nepal did in the past few years has been a transformation of historic proportion. It really happened elsewhere in the world that a traditional force and a revolutionary force from came to a negotiating table, set the common future agenda of socio-political restructuring, accomplished the journey from bullet to ballot, and the entire process culminate in the making of the constitution by the people's elected representatives, incorporating the uniquely possessive agendas for an inclusive society. As all of you are well aware that the process of peace and democratic transformation was initiated from 12-point understanding between the then seven parliamentary political parties and the then CPN Maoist led by me. Today, we have successfully completed the very sensitive and delicate part of the peace process, which is the management of ex-combatants and management of arms and ammunition. Elsewhere in the world, it has been seen that it is a very crucial and more or less impossible to manage arms and ammunition and combatants in a formal legal army. Therefore, our peace process is quite clear that it is a successful study of the peace process in this 21st century. Today, we have the constitution that embodies hopes and desire of 28 million Nepali people, the constitution that we took upon as the best possible outcome of compromise, accommodating diverse and often contesting aspirations. It is the constitution that guarantees human rights and fundamental freedom to all citizens without any discrimination. It incorporates most of the rights of and freedom contained in the international human rights instrument, the constitution that has been appreciated by our friends around the world as uniquely progressive and forward-looking. Social justice was on top of agenda, the people's struggle my party led in the past, and today the pillar of social justice is thus firmly set up in the constitution. It seeks to promote socio-economic justice to the backward and different ethnic communities of the country. State policies are aimed to uplift and empower socially backward women, Dalits, Adivasi Janajatis, Madhesi, Tharu, minorities, persons with disability. Backward classes, sexual minorities, youths, peasant workers and citizens from backward regions and economically poor background. As a unique measure of social justice, the Constitution has spelled out ways to ensure gender equality. It provides that the President and Vice President should come from different community and from different gender. Similar provision applies in the election of Speaker and Deputy Speaker of the House of Representatives, as well as Chair and Vice Chair of the National Assembly. One-third representation of women in the Federal Parliament and Provincial Assemblies, and 40% in elected local bodies has been guaranteed. Journey from an armed rebellion to a successful constitution making was not easy by any means. We faced many hurdles and had to come through odds of all kinds. With untiring resolve, we marched ahead. It was a resolve to transform society, a resolve to do away with injustice and backwardness, and a resolve to see better days in people's life. It is quite clear that in accomplishing this historic change, we received valuable support from India and friends and well-wishers around the world. Distinguished audience, formation of pre-election left alliance and post-election merger of the two largest communist forces in Nepal has been yet another transformative course in Nepal's political development. A unified progressive left force was a long-held desire of our people. Majority of them used to vote for the left parties, but it was divided votes as long as left parties were not won. Having accomplished a political process and having established a people's agenda through people's constitution, we as progressive political force faced one more challenge, a huge challenge of preserving the gains, a challenge of translating the constitutional aspirations into concrete deliverable on the ground and in people's daily life. Divided, we could not do this. United, we can. This very imperative strongly drove the left forces to form an electoral alliance under one manifesto, first and then the merger. It was a serious and bold decision, and the consequence was rewarding for the left parties and for the stability and better governance of the country. In the provincial and federal election, the left alliance and now the Nepal Communist Party alone, no UML, no Maoist, not any tail in the name, only Nepal Communist Party, received a resounding mandate of the people of Nepal. Today, Nepal Communist Party not only has a robust government at the center, but also in 6 of the 7 provinces, newly formed province in vote share count, Communist Party of Nepal tops 74 out of 77 districts of Nepal, including 17 of the 20 Tarai Madhes districts. We are fully convinced this victory is the result of people's trust on us. Trust that we would provide the country a strong and stable government. Trust that this stable government would instead provide an enabling environment to carry forth the country's pressing developmental works. Trust that we were competent and committed to root out the evils of corruption and poor governance that held up the country's development. Trust that our leadership can effectively carry forth the national agenda, protect the national interest and enhance the dignity of the nation. And on our part, we are committed that we will not let our people down, we will not let that trust dissipate. Ladies and gentlemen, political process over what remains now for Nepal is economic transformation. Political gains cannot sustain in the absence of economic transformation. Achieving economic transformation is going to be an uphill task. Even today, our society is most agrarian and agriculture is largely subsistence-based, directly needling land pooling, commercialization of agriculture and investment in better inputs and technology. Growth and prosperity is impossible without massive industrialization that requires competence, capacity, and entrepreneurial orientation of private sector, not merely rent-seeking tendency. Nepal's private sector is still nascent phase requiring empowerment. To reach our growth target, domestic resources are far from enough. We are forced on acquiring more and more of foreign investment as well. Transport infrastructure is not only the measure of country's prosperity level, but also the foundation that people growth of overall economy and help diversify economic activities. Without seamless road connectivity, industrialization is impossible. A number of villages in Nepal are yet to see a decent blacktopped road, and top task before us is to end this situation. Both our countries release today the treasure of demographic dividend. From development perspective, this is a rare opportunity. What our youths need is the quality education that empowers them with the sort of skill required to soldier and sustain country's developmental process. Likewise, we need research and innovation center. Innovation center is a center of excellence. Key to all these sectoral transformation is the issue of governance, which is yet to be improved in our country. To transform governance, we are advancing legal and institutional reform in Nepal. We are equally aware that governance reform is possible only when those of us in society is driving seat led by concrete example. Journey to prosperity for us is not a lone venture. We see our prosperity closely tied with the prosperity of our big neighbors and with the kind of partnership we are able to forge with them. As a close neighbor, we are delighted to see India's rapid march on the path of development and its rising global stature. Be it the massive scale of infrastructure build-up or the development of industrial corridor, be it the world-class advancement in information and communication engineering, or the launching of satellites, and above all, the almost 7 decades of uninterrupted democratic practice and successful consolidation of democratic institutions in the undoubtedly the world's largest democracy. India's multidimensional progress has not only inspired us, but also provided a solid lesson that things are doable. Dear friends, ours is a civilizational bond from even before our two societies were born as a modern nation state with current defined boundary. I want to repeat it. Ours is a civilizational bond formed even before our two societies were born as modern nation states with current defined boundary. We have jointly inherited the treasure of tradition, affluence of ancient knowledge, and even the shared culture and lower myths and mythology, art and architecture, literature and lifestyle that have become the distinct hallmark of our relations. Today, India is cruising on its development journey with the slogan of Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, while Nepal's development vision is captured in Samriddha Nepal, Sukhi Nepali. Both are the transformative visions for inclusive and sustained development process that seeks not to leave anyone behind. As a milestone of the journey toward prosperous Nepal, we seek to graduate from LDC status at an early date and acquire a middle income country status by 2030, which is the deadline for the achievement of sustainable development goals. Beyond the respective border, our two countries do share a dream of regional prosperity and better regional cooperation. Just a week ago, the 4th summit of the BIMSTEC, heads of the state and government, successfully concluded in Kathmandu. The leaders' declaration has well articulated the region's aspiration for peaceful, prosperous, and sustainable of Bengal region, and several key decisions have been made in this direction, including in enhancing regional connectivity. As the current chair of another important regional process, namely SAARC, Nepal's desire is to revive it and see a conducive environment for early convening of the stalled summit. We believe that SAARC and BIMSTEC do not substitute but complement each other. Beyond the region and on global front, both India and Nepal are part of the 17 sustainable development goals to be achieved by 2030. We are both advocates in international forums of the issues uniquely faced by the developing countries and do raise voice for a fairer and most inclusive global development architecture. We speak for a better level playing field for all countries. Ladies and gentlemen, you may ask, have our relation always been smooth and trouble-free? Of course not. we have seen difficult times too. In retrospection, we can easily say that the difficult times could have been avoided, and had we seen things in more enlightened perspective and judged things better. Nonetheless, good thing is that even in the difficult times, we remain engaged and remain sincerely effortful to free ourselves from those intermittent irritants. We do not let such irritants undermine the strong foundation of our historic relations. Now we need to look forward, and in doing so, we must ensure that mistakes of the past are not repeated or will not repeat it. We have to acknowledge that relationship between neighbors is of unique nature, and that mutual trust, understanding and respect for each other, sensitivities and concern contribute to strengthen the foundation of such relationship. Respect for sovereignty, territorial integrity and non-interference in the internal affairs helps buttress the trust which is absolutely essential to govern a friendly relationship. Let me tell you frankly, small neighbors have some distinct sensitivity that need to be understood and respected. With India, our development partnership is substantial, and we are committed to deepen this partnership further. After decades, we have been able to form a strong government with robust mandate, and we see this an excellent opportunity to strengthen our relationship and level of our cooperation. Lately, following the guidance from the highest political leadership, both our countries are focused on timely implementation of bilateral agreement and understanding that are in the process of implementation. We have already started to see positive results on the ground. I am happy to note that Prime Minister Modi ji visited Nepal four times in as many years. This will be remembered as a historic development in the annals of Nepal-India relations. Because lastly, during the 17 years of long span of time, no Prime Minister had visited Nepal from India. But this time, four times in a short span of time. This itself proved the new initiative we are going to take. Cross-border infrastructure has justifiably received top priority in our bilateral development engagement. Soon, we are going to see the operation of cross-border railway. Cross-border integrated checkposts are being developed at key border points to facilitate and smoothen trade, transit and movement of people. Road links, our respective highway with main border points are being upgraded. Bottlenecks still exist at some of these points which we need to attend to a prompt manner. Given Nepal's potential and India's massive need, management of water and hydropower is a key area of our cooperation. In this respect, I want to focus that not only the energy, not only the hydropower, but the management of water itself is a multi-dimensional aspect. I want to stress on it. A couple of big projects are already under implementation, the success of which will set fascinating precedents for more such mega projects. Specific sector aside, we are also assessing the overall picture of Nepal-India relation in its totality too. Both sides have appreciated the need to update and upgrade these relations in tune with the realities of 21st century. And to this end, we have jointly assigned the eminent persons group to provide us useful recommendations. The group will hopefully submit its report soon. Our relation must scale new heights of mutual satisfaction. Ladies and gentlemen, as I said earlier, Nepal-India relations are not only built on the shared attributes of long history of coexistence as close neighbors, but also driven by the fact that our destinies are interlinked. Our relations are not confined to government level alone. We have a much broader spectrum of people-to-people contacts that provide a solid foundation to our relations. Our relations are both deep and extensive. We have similar aspirations and face identical challenges in pursuit of respective development goals. We are both democracies, and hence, at times, our process looks slow, messy, as well as full of noise. Working with multi-party, multiple stakeholders is naturally time-consuming. However, the end result of this process is likely to be much more self-sustaining. Both Nepal and India are highly diverse societies, and both of us face challenge of managing this diversity. We can learn from how each of us tackle these challenges and in the meantime, learn to be appreciative of each other's effort. Despite progress, poverty is still in our countries, in villages, hundreds of thousands of households are still deprived of basic public goods, while our cities still have slums at every nook and corner. How long will it take for us to ensure that our people have a decent home, decent clothes, and quality food with adequate nutritional content? How long will it take for us to ensure that our youth receive world-class education that makes them competent and competitive? These and similar are indeed pressing questions that steer both our countries, and these tell us why growth and development should be deemed more crucial than any other consideration. Dear friends, this is why we have been saying that we want a robust economic partnership with India. A partnership that enables both our countries to grow together. A partnership that helps us, our youth, to secure decent job opportunities at home. A partnership that fosters mutually rewarding and beneficial trade relationship. A partnership that fosters the process of industrialization, flow of investment, transfer of technology and technological know-how, and to connect our economies in value chain. A partnership that leads to better utilization of natural resources, including our vast hydro resources for our mutual benefits. A partnership that leads to seamless cross-border infrastructure of all kinds. Partnership that connects our people through tourism and builds on our cultural treasures. That means such a partnership will have a strong economic dimension. It will be fully appreciative of all those positive attributes of centuries-old civilization, component of our relation, and in meantime, it will stand on the solid foundation of the fundamental principle of interstate relations, namely equality, mutual respect, mutual benefit, and non-interference. I am convinced that a peaceful, stable, prosperous, and democratic Nepal. I am convinced that a peaceful, stable, prosperous, and democratic Nepal is and will be in the interest of our neighbors, region, and beyond. I would like to conclude with these words. I thank you once again for this privilege for me. Thank you very much.
Mr. Prachanda has agreed to take a few questions, although he's pressed for time, so I'd be very grateful for those who are asking questions, if they could identify themselves and also keep the question brief. Thank you. Thank you. Yes.
Good evening, sir. My name is Dhairya Maheshwari, and I'm from National Herald newspaper. My question is, you mentioned the Eminent Persons Group and the report is due to submit later this year. So one of the issues is the revision of the India-Nepal Friendship Treaty of 1950. So could you just specify what are Nepal's reservations about this treaty and why does it want it changed in reference to the defense component and the reciprocity of property rights? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I think that this one is a very important historic question. I have not gone through what exactly is there in the report of EPG. But I hope that amicable solution has been suggested in that document. I can only say that after going through that document, we can concretely comment on this document. But one thing is clear, we are in the historical opportunities of strengthening the level of our friendship and cooperation. Therefore, everything that will be suggested will be in favor of our relationship, in favor of our economic cooperation, security and all these things. That is my understanding. Thank you.
Pastor D.K. Jay.
My name is Dinesh Jain. I'm a retired ambassador who has had over long years, off and on, something to do with our bilateral relations. First of all, I would like to compliment Your Excellency for a very positive and forward-looking address. In the same vein, I would like to ask you two questions, both pertaining to the second part of your address, India-Nepal relations. My first question is that one abiding underlying feature of our bilateral relations, especially after King Tribhuvan, has been a pall of misunderstanding and suspicion, which has impeded normal, healthy, friendly, cooperative relationship between our two countries. Now that Nepal is at an important point just after very promising elections and transition, how would you suggest that both sides address this problem which has affected our bilateral relations progression? My second question is that King Prithvi Narayan Shah had spoken of Nepal as a yam between two stones. He alluded to India and China, two large countries on the two sides of Nepal. Pertaining to the geographical location, I'm not deliberately saying strategic location because I do not think it is best to be in a competing relationship. Now, in a situation like this, Nepal, to my mind, Nepal can have two approaches. One is either or, pitting one against the other, like a zero-sum situation. And the other approach could be a win-win situation in which Nepal can have a normal, friendly, healthy relationship with each of the two countries independently. To my mind, one option is very obvious. Nepal has followed one option consistently through the decades. Looking forward, how do you foresee and perceive Nepal's relations with these two countries without impinging one on the other? Thank you.
Thank you. This one is also very important concern of both the countries. I want to stress here that there is a tremendous political change is going on in Nepal. Previously, there was a feudal autocracy as the core of the leadership, monarchy. And now, tremendous democratic change is going on. Therefore, this new situation has created a very conducive atmosphere to define the relation between our two countries in a completely new perspective. Previously, feudal monarch always tried to pay with these two neighbors and always use divine and rule to preserve its throne. Now the situation has changed. Therefore, there is no question of playing cards of India or playing cards of China. Now, very positive and favorable situation has already been created with a long struggle and sacrifice of Nepalese people. There is an understanding. According to my analysis and my study, fundamentally new situation has been created. No intellectual and no general public want to play this India-China card, and they want to be benefited from both of our neighbors. As you mentioned, that during the period of Tribhuvan, he himself, as a feudal monarch, tried to preserve his throne by using these play games. And as you mentioned about Prithvinarayan Saha, he unified the country by the feudal means, and he defined Nepal, as you mentioned, in between India and China. It is a very defensive and very negative definition according to my understanding. Now, whole international situation, regional situation, and the understanding of Nepalese peoples has been enriched in such a way that that definition will not work. Today, we think that developed and prosperous India and developed and prosperous China will not be a difficulty and problem for the prosperity of Nepal, prosperity of Nepalese people. It is the high time and huge opportunity is there to bridge these neighbors and to be benefited from the development of both the neighboring countries. This is the general understanding that is developing among the masses of people in Nepal. At the same time, I also want to clearly mention that India and Nepal has a very unique relation. As I mentioned in my speech, our history, our culture, our civilization as a whole, our economic ties, our political understanding, in an overall sense, lifestyle. We are having a very unique, no comparison will be there with any other issues. There was a time when people have some ideological sentiment, some petty bourgeois revolutionary sentimentism was there during that period. There were so many ups and downs. But now, situation has been changed. Therefore, there cannot be a comparison with the relation of Nepal with India and with the relation of Nepal with China. No comparison can be made. We previously, monarch, tried to play this game sometimes through India, sometimes through China, and always divided the people with that slogan. We new leaders of the political spectrum are convinced that the history has ended, that kinds of playing games has already been ended. Now, new initiation has been there, that we are having a very unique relation with India, either for political democracy or for economic development or for security reasons. Because all our natural resources, our ebb and flow of our natural resources from Nepal to India, it dictates us. Our civilizational history always dictates us to be very unique with India. No comparison can be there. Therefore, I think that although that kind of discussion and discourse was there, but now fundamentally situation has been changed. Now high time is there to clearly define our relations with India and our relation with China with a concrete analysis of the concrete condition. It is quite clear. Thank you.
Young man at the back, yes.
Namaskar, Prachanda ji. Bharat Mata Bhai ko swagat cha. I am Siddhant, representing Global Youth. My question to you is that since you were the Prime Minister in 2016 for 9 months, and now the KPOD government has also completed around 9 months, so what change do you see in Nepal and India's relations from then and now?
Thank you. During my last tenure for 9 to 10 months, I have an opportunity to create a very balanced and friendly relation with both our neighbors. Particularly, I want to convey my heartfelt thanks for Indian political leadership and academic circle to create a conducive atmosphere to unify the nation as a whole in Nepal. During my last tenure, there was a serious problem in Tarakadesh, mountainous area and hilly region, a kind of division and distrust was there. I got the opportunity with your support and cooperation to create a very favorable atmosphere to unify the nation as a whole and to create an atmosphere of democratic transition through democratic election. And at the same time, I had also very short span of time was there, but I have an opportunity to clearly indicates that if leadership is serious enough and committed enough, economic development is possible. Because during my last tenure, 7.5% of GDP, this was a record after 25 years of our history, it has been established. And the relation with both India and China has been balanced in such a way that now there is a very positive developments are there. And Prime Minister K.P. Oli, when he visited last time here, very positive developments are there. And the visit of Prime Minister Modi ji in Nepal, time and again within a short span of time, also created very positive atmosphere. I think that during my tenure, 10 months tenure, has created a ground for the development. Today, Prime Minister K.P. Oli is trying to move forward on that ground. Last week, I have the opportunity to appeal the masses of people in Torai, Madhesh, number 2 province, with Prime Minister. And both Prime Minister and I myself appeal the masses of people. We are serious enough to address the genuine demands and aspirations of Madhesh people. Therefore, it is a very positive development. I am fully satisfied with this development. And other issues that about railway links, about infrastructure building, about development in agro-based industry in agriculture sector, so many positive developments are there. Both Modi ji and K.P. Oli ji, they are trying their best to enhance, to improve the bilateral relation. Therefore, I feel that I have the opportunity to create that atmosphere of improvement in our bilateral relationship. And Prime Minister K.P. Oli is also very serious enough this time to improve and strengthen the relations with India. Without having a good understanding and relation with our neighbor, it is more or less impossible to create a stable and prosperous Nepal. we all are convinced in that. Therefore, I do not want to compare my tenure and tenure of this because this is also my party's leadership. KP Oli is also the chairman of my party. Therefore, I want to strengthen this government. I want to unify the party and consolidate the party for political stability and economic development of the country. I want to create a conducive atmosphere with India. Yes, during my tenure, I have the opportunity to have a very confidential and very confident relationship with India. I want to continue it with new circumstances. Thank you.
Yes.
Myself, Subodh. I am a PhD scholar from JNU. So I have a question related to the flood management in the India-Nepal border areas, because Prime Minister of both the countries, they visited each other and they have never talked about the question the people of these border regions ask, and the problems the farmers of these regions face every year, and the blame game always is going on both from both the sides, that India has built dams and barrage on the rivers. That's why people from Nepal, that means Madhesi region people, are facing problems. And in, from India side, people say that Nepal do not provide information regarding when they are releasing water, and that's why they are facing the problems. So that's my question. Thank you.
Anyway, one thing is quite clear, that both peoples on both sides of border face the same challenges from natural disaster, flood and other issues. Therefore, we are interlinked in such a way by natural resources and natural disaster and something like that. Therefore, it dictates us to collectively take new initiative to satisfy or to resolve the problems created by natural disaster. Today, I am fully convinced and I am really happy that both the leadership of Nepal and India are engaged to create a positive atmosphere to resolve the issue. Previously, in Nepal side, there was a serious concern about the dam and the road constructed in the border side of India, that has created a problem of flood and all these problems. And this time, both Modi ji and Oli ji came to an understanding to resolve this issue within 1 year. Therefore, gradually, the situation is moving forward in a very positive direction. Let us try our best to support this new initiative to resolve all these issues.
General Mehta.
Your Excellency, welcome back to India. My name is General Mehta.
I know you very well.
No, this is for the benefit of the audience, other people. It says former Prime Minister of Nepal, when can we expect that you will be the incumbent Prime Minister of Nepal? Is there an arrangement in the during the time of the merger that the Prime Minister's tenure will be shared between the two parties that merged together? That is simply my question. And if you allow me the indulgence, there is some perception in India, I think that lingers still, that in this merger and in this Nepal Communist Party of India, Prime Minister Oli is perceived to be pro-China, and incumbent Prime Minister Prachanda is perceived to be pro-India. How do you reconcile this?
Mr. General Mehta, I already explained this pro-India and pro-China cards. It is a old tactics. It will not work now. And it is not true that Prime Minister Oli is pro-Chinese. For more than 25 years, he has been accused as pro-Indian in Nepalese media and Nepalese And 2-3 years back, there was a rumor and there was a kind of perception, as you correctly mentioned, about pro-China. And today, when better relation is developing between Modi ji and Oli ji, again some people are trying to make a rumor that Oli ji again became pro-Indian. Therefore, this is the dynamics of politics. It's not a, such a strategic issue. As I already defined, that now political situation is qualitatively different from the time of monarchy. Therefore, I myself, peace process and democratic transformation, I saw so many ups and downs and twists and turns in the process. I took so many risks to create a conducive atmosphere for concluding peace process, for democratic transformation, to create a atmosphere of confidence and trust between Nepal and India, and even between Nepal and China. Therefore, humor will not work. I think that things are moving in a correct direction. All academic circles should come together to encourage the leadership to enhance and to strengthen this bilateral relations that is developing in a very positive direction.
Yes, madam, last question.
It is about 12 years since you laid down arms yourself, and it's about 12 years since the last Nepali was killed in the revolution that you led. Would you say, sir, now with 12 years having gone by, would you say that there could have been another way that you could have overthrown what you thought was an extremely oppressive feudal monarchical regime? I ask this because there are many resistance movements bubbling across the world just now, in our part of the world too. So would you have done it differently now that you've seen 12 years go by?
Once again, I want to go to General Mehta. As you raised one part of the question, that what about the prime ministership, sharing of prime ministership, or something like that. I want to make it clear that we appeal the masses of people for a stable government for 5 years. And in the process of merging two communist parties, we have some understanding. But our understanding will not create any doubt and confusion among the masses of people for 5 years of stable government. Remaining things you will see in the course of development. I do not want to elaborate the issue. Thank you. And about... I want to go to the questions of Mrs. Nandini Singh. You are quite correct that during the 12 years of underground armed rebellion and 12 years of peace process, these are quite different and qualitatively new experience is there. I think that to transform war into peace is just something very risky and challenging job. I have the opportunity to transform war into peace. Time and again, I used to mention about Emperor Ashoka, who was a warrior and later on the Buddhist and explorer of peace. I have the opportunity. No individual really get that kind of opportunity to transform war into peace in a very successful way. I have not any other alternative. I do not see any other alternative than to peace and democratic transition. Therefore, time and again, my old friends from different parts of the different country, I appeal them, please try to understand the dynamics of change that is going on all over the world. Don't follow dogmatism, sectarianism, and extremism in such a way that you cannot create the atmosphere of peace and transition. Therefore, I am trying to appeal to look the example of Nepal. We have already empowered the women, Dalit, Janjati, and all other laboring people. And we are having a very inclusive democracy through peace and through democratic means. Therefore, this is the high time. If people do not want to understand the dynamics of change that is going on all over the world, and they will not follow the process of peace and democratic transformation, the result will not be positive, will not be good for them. And how far these 12 years of peace process is concerned, although there are also difficulties and challenges, when I took the decision in such a way, in Baluwata, at that time, Prime Minister was Sushil Koirala of Nepali Congress. I just came from the cantonment from Tarai, Madhesh. And I explained to the Prime Minister and other ministers and political leaders of different parties that today, not tomorrow, if you will wait tomorrow, hundreds of people may be killed in the cantonment. I saw the situation. Only today we can resolve this issue in a very historic way without any bloodshed. Because there was a very serious and critical situation is going to develop. I am very seriously, I explained to the leaders of Nepal's party and Prime Minister and other ministers, concerned ministers, that today within 2-3 hours cantonment should be dismantled. Arms and ammunition should be managed. Then only our peace process will be a historic one. And the role of development understanding, comprehensive peace agreement, and all other issues can be resolved in such a way that history will always bless us, and all over the world we will set a reference example for the peace and transition in a democratic transition. Later on, all leaders convene, and within few years, we settle the issue of arms and ammunition, huge amount of arms and ammunition. It was not a question of 2-3 arms or something like that. Huge amounts of arms and ammunition, and thousands of combatants. Therefore, when I took that decision, you all are well aware that I have a risk inside my party. My party is split in that issue. I was the leader of the single largest party. But because I took that risk to manage arms and ammunition and to settle the issue of combatants, my party is split. Time and again, I became third largest party. I have not any regret on it. I think that I took the historic decision for democracy, for the betterment, peace and the betterment of our people. I have some review of these 12 years. One is that 12-point understanding has been set with the support of India and other international friends. But after the election, I have some sentimental decision I took, and I departed from the fundamental orientation of Kubel point of standing, fundamental orientation of competence. I have some serious review on that. I do not want to elaborate right now. Anyway, at the same time, I have reviewed, and time and again, publicly also I mentioned that I have also had some sentimental decision not to make president to Mr. Girija Prasad Koirala, co-signatories for comprehensive peace agreement and leader of all this democratic transition. Without having this towering personality of Mr. Girija Prasad Koirala, it would have been more or less impossible to create that atmosphere. As I mentioned, that without the support of our friends, neighboring friends particularly, you know, it would not be possible to have this situation. But I had some shortcomings, because I just came from insurgency, and it is not a personal mistake, it is a circumstance that forced me to be more sentimental. Now I am not in sentiment. You know, I have learned the old norms and values of democratic transition. For me to understand war, it took 10 years. For me to understand peace and democracy, it took 12 years. Now I am a full conviction. With conviction, I can tell you that that kinds of sentimental things will not be repeated. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. The most enlightening, introspective, reflective, and such a candid talk. It was a great pleasure. We'll have a call.
On behalf of Indian Council of World Affairs, I would like to thank His Excellency Mr. Pushpa Kamal Dahal Prachanda, former Prime Minister of Nepal and Chairman of Nepal Communist Party, for delivering the 31st Sapru House Lecture and answering the questions from the audience. We are also thankful to Sri M.J. Akbar, Minister of State for External Affairs, for his kind presence here for this lecture. Our gratitude also to each one of you who have taken the time to be present for this lecture today. May I now invite you all to join us for a high tea at the foyer.